This week, Matthew McConaughey's life is broadcast 24 hours a day on EDtv.
Viggo Mortensen lures housewife Diane Lane into the psychedelic 60s in A Walk on the Moon.
And Claire Danes stars in the big screen version of The Mod Squad.
We really screwed up tonight. Get your feet off that table and stand up. Get up.
What are you talking about, man? We got the job done.
Three budding criminals switch gears and become would-be cops in the Mod Squad, causing a disciplinary problem down at the station in one of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times, and across the aisle from me is this week's guest critic.
I'm Kenneth Turan, film critic for the Los Angeles Times. It's good to be here, Roger.
You know, Ken, every time I go to the movies, I think of you because of the Cannes Film Festival a few years ago. You turned me on to this Timex watch that lights up real bright in the dark so that you can see how much longer a movie has. I use it constantly.
It's the best friend a critic has.
It is. The only friend sometimes. Okay, first movie. The Mod Squad is a retread of the old TV series, which is back with a talented cast, a good-looking production, a lot of humor, and a script so lame-brained it depends on the same investigative techniques first perfected by Nancy Drew. The movie stars Omar Epps, Giovanni Ribisi, and Claire Danes, all talented actors as young troublemakers who were headed for a life of crime until they were recruited by police captain Dennis Farina to become an undercover team.
There are people breathing down my neck to get rid of all three of you.
Why? What did we do?
Arson, assault, and robbery. Now get out. And remember, I am the only thing keeping you clowns out of prison.
The squad stakes out a nightclub, and then Epps and Ribisi challenge a suspect, and Epps uses the time-honored cinematic technique of running across the roofs of cars. The Mod Squad doesn't carry guns or badges except for Ribisi, who has stolen his father's gun. It makes him feel safe. He'd be a lot safer without it.
Do perimeter search, all right? Cover me.
What?
Cover me.
There's a running gag about how Epps treasures his beloved Lincoln Continental, and Ribisi and Danes are forever finding new ways to trash it. I like the energy that the cast brought to this movie, and I like the look that director Scott Silver and his cinematographer Ellen Curris are able to create. But who dreamed up this plot? The key investigative technique of the Mod Squad consists of sneaking up on people, peeping through windows, hiding in closets, and tape recording conversations while hiding behind corners. And of course, all of the bad guys cooperate by carefully explaining all of their plans and revealing all of their secrets while the tape recorder is running. With a halfway decent screenplay, the Mod Squad might have really amounted to something, but what a waste of resources.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the original Mod Squad was not exactly one of the great treasures of Western civilization.
Not precisely, no.
But you really miss it. You know, that had something that this doesn't have. And, you know, I really felt it's like they spent more time on the sunglasses than they did on the plot. Like, which Foster Grants are you going to wear? And, you know, it's all these talented people. They're great people in this, and they're just, I guess they just like to play dress up. Everyone wanted to be an outlaw. So they didn't pay attention to the script because they got to act tough.
It's all there. It's all there for a really smart, fun Mod Squad. And instead,
you get this piece of nonsense.
How did you like it when Ribisi is hiding behind the wall with his microcassette? Now, you're a journalist. You use those little recorders. Have you ever found one that can pick up flawless voices 20 feet away outdoors on a windy day?
This is one of those silly movies where you just want to yell at the screen and say, no, no, that's an idiotic thing to do.
I'm going to try that. Every time after I look at my watch, I'll use that line.
Okay, next up is Doug's first movie, a title which is no surprise because the Doug in question is only 12 and a half years old. That's young to have your very own film, especially if you're just an animated character. Intrepid and resourceful, but enough of a regular kid to think best over milk and cookies, Doug is never far from best pal Skeeter and loyal dog Porkchop. Doug even helps Skeeter search for the legendary monster of Lucky Duck Lake, but the two friends get separated. Schoolboy Roger and his pals set a trap for Skeeter, but it turns out the surprise is on them.
Very funny, you guys. Hearty har. Oh, very believable, too. Did you rent it or did you make it yourself? Well, you had your fun. Now you can go home.
Yes, the monster is real. and a real sweetheart to boot. Doug names him Herman Melville because he tried to eat a copy of Moby Dick and registers him at school as, don't ask, a female exchange student.
Hermione, no! Bad! That's dirty! Hermione, remarkable work! So primitive, so free!
But Herman's presence unnerves Patty Mayonnaise, the one girl in the world Doug wants most to impress.
I saw you all over her in the cafeteria.
Come on, Patty, she's not even a girl.
I know you think I must be dumb because I believed all that monster stuff before, but I hope you don't think I'm that gullible, Doug.
Only 77 minutes long and rated G, Doug's first movie is an offshoot of the super popular Saturday morning cartoon show. Though it has its share of kid-friendly vomit and toilet jokes, it also deals smartly with real-world problems like pollution, SWAT teams, and bogus journalists. Best of all, Doug, created by Jim Jenkins, has found a way to convincingly talk about values and the importance of doing the right thing without making kids gag. Both wised up and innocent, Doug's first movie will charm adults as it engages their children. It deserves what else but an animated thumbs up.
But not for me. I thought the movie was kind of flat, and it was all kind of the same stuff over and over and over. The characters didn't really distinguish themselves as being individuals to me. At the end, it seemed to me like this was kind of a Rugrats wannabe. It just didn't have the same sparkle as Rugrats.
I think maybe Rugrats sparkles a little too much. I mean, maybe pushes too hard. I like the sweetness of this. I like the simplicity of it. I really like the way that they were smart without overdoing it, without being in your face and screaming all the time. And that really appealed to me. You don't see that a lot. And I was really gratified that kids like this. This is a very popular show. I was astonished that it was popular.
Well, they do like it on TV.
Yeah.
Well, I've never seen it on TV, but I know they like it on TV because I've been told they do. But, you know, as an adult, reviewing the mysterious monster of Lucky Duck Lake, I wonder if it's not possible that there is an age group this movie is for and that I am outside that age group. For example, maybe if you're 8 or 9, what do you think?
Oh, yeah. And I think, again, I think of mainly, I would not necessarily send, even though I liked it, I would not necessarily send adults on their own to see this.
Oh, no, I wouldn't either.
But I think if
you're going... I definitely wouldn't.
If you're going with your kids, I think you're going to be pleasantly surprised.
Okay, coming up later in the show, Matthew McConaughey lives every moment of his life on television in EDtv.
You're on television.
Oh, my God.
And coming up next, Diane Lane is a restless wife in A Walk on the Moon.
No one will buy these.
Well, if they see you in one.
I have my first date.
What?
At a summer resort in the Catskills, Diane Lane plays a Jewish mother whose daughter, played by Anna Paquin, is nervously going out on her first date. It's the summer of 1969, and families stay at the resort all week long while husbands work in town and come out for the weekends. Lane's character and her husband, played by Liev Schreiber, have been married since they were both very young.
Where's my kiss?
I have a date, Daddy.
A date?
Ross is taking me to the Pines. There's a rock band there.
Who's Ross? I missed one weekend already. There's a Ross?
She's bored with her marriage and bored with her husband. It's the summer of the Woodstock Festival, and she's very aware that it's being held not far away. She suggests a little experimentation to her husband in their usual routines.
What would you have in mind?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I'm sorry. I just...
No. No, no. That's all right.
Morning.
Hey, pretty lady, there's a bossy on my tail, so I ain't got much time.
Left alone again the following week, she meets the Blouse Man, a salesman who drives from resort to resort, selling clothes from his truck.
Keep it a couple days, you know. I don't like it, you get back. You do? Pay me later.
That's Viggo Mortensen as the Blouse Man there, and although he's always an interesting actor, he is wrong, wrong, wrong for this role. He may be a great lover, but I just don't see him as a Blouse Man. I think the regular Blouse Man has been kidnapped by the casting director to make room for a stud who looks like he belongs on the cover of a paperback romance. A Walk on the Moon is basically a woman's sexual fantasy, one unforgettable summer of lust in the Catskills. And the effort to make it sincere and moving made me squirm. It's all a setup. And the talented cast is wasted on a story so artificial and contrived that, yes, there is even a lovemaking scene set underneath a waterfall. in the Catskills in August, that waterfall would have about 16 people under it, most of them with inner tubes, don't you say?
I do. You know, when I actually spent a lot of my misspent youth at bungalow colonies, familiar with bungalow colonies, and this was not a very convincing bungalow colony. I felt bad. You know, I like the actors. I like Diane Lane. I think she's one of the great underappreciated American actresses. But also, it felt contrived to me. I didn't really believe any of it. But it's so earnest. You know, I feel bad saying this. I say, you should like this film. It's so well-meaning.
I liked Anna Paquin. Now, she was the young girl who won the Oscar for the piano. But the movie just kind of never really persuaded me.
It didn't persuade me either. It just kind of sits there, and you want to take the actress and put them in something else and say, you know, guys, we have a great script for you over here. Why don't you do that movie?
You got it. Okay, coming up next, Matthew McConaughey lives and loves 24 hours a day on EDtv.
I had a year at junior college. Home with Bearcats.
Scary. What'd you study?
Studying? Geez, that'd have been a big help.
Before there was EDtv, there was Ed, a feckless 31-year-old San Francisco video store clerk with a weakness for Burt Reynolds. There was also a hopeless cable network called True TV that was getting buried in the ratings by the Gardening Channel. Then program director Ellen DeGeneres gets an idea. Why not put a regular person's life on television every minute of every day? When Ed, played by the irresistible Matthew McConaughey, auditions, it's clear that a star is about to be born. At least the network is willing to take a chance on him. And so is Ed's knuckleheaded brother, Ray, played by Woody Harrelson. The rest of Ed's family is not so sure.
They show you having sex?
Oh, Al. Look, kissing and hugging.
Nudity? Ed, you're not going to be nude.
Why would I be nude, Mom?
What kind of a show is this? It's a filthy show.
It is not a filthy show.
Have you even read the whole contract? Do you even know what's in it?
Ed takes the job. And gradually, Ray's girlfriend, played by Jenna Elfman, begins to wonder if maybe Ed is the cuter brother after all.
I've had about 19 beers.
Hey, Barry, did you see that?
What?
The girl. The look?
Yeah.
She likes the Ed guy better than she likes the brother.
As Ed gets increasingly famous for just being Ed, an ambitious femme fatale, deliciously played by Elizabeth Hurley, sets her sights on America's newest star.
Why don't you come around here? I can make you dinner. And maybe you could bring a video and, we can make a night of it.
Clearly, EDtv is amusingly cast. Elfman from TV's Dharma and Greg has a warm screen presence, and McConaughey, who could teach Ed a thing or two about the ups and downs of celebrity, shows how effective he can be in the right part. Director Ron Howard has a nice touch with actors, and he certainly understands comedy. But the film, like television itself, is frustrating as well as entertaining. For every clever moment, there's a contrived one. For every inspired laugh, there's an awkward misfire. And though it's not EDtv's fault, the shadow of the more adventurous The Truman Show and its similar storyline falls heavily on the new film. With genuine laughs a rare commodity these days, you have to appreciate what EDtv offers, so I'm giving it a thumbs up. But the movie does leave you with the junk food munchies almost as soon as it's over.
You know, I agree with you except about the thumbs up. I'm very close, but I'm kind of marginally thumbs down, and partially because The Truman Show was a more ambitious movie, but
absolutely.
Also because if you're going to show somebody's life on TV more or less 24 hours a day, then you can have a lot of fun with the paradoxes that can create, and this movie doesn't seem to do that. The people right away have intimate personal moments on TV. Yeah. The camera is always there for these moments and usually has the right shot. I mean, considering they're basically only using one or two cameras, how do they get in for those close-ups and how do they get around the room and, cover the supporting characters and so forth so that actually you realize after a while, this isn't a live TV show, this is a sitcom that's pretending to be a live TV show. So they don't, the thing about Truman Show was it was really pretty consistent about its point of view, being all these hidden cameras.
Yeah, no, I think Truman Show clearly, is way ahead in the race between these two films. And yeah, I was just troubled by, often I feel with Ron Howard that it's just everything is right down the middle of the fairway. Mm-hmm. It's never too long, it's never too short, it's just, it never pushes the audience, it never challenges the audience, it's just content to make everyone smile. And part of me likes that and part of me says, I want a little bit more.
I agree with you about the actors. I mean, that's kind of been a theme on today's show. Actors in material that isn't quite as good as what they bring to it.
As they deserve.
Yeah, okay, we come now to our next film, Among Giants, a film which is far from perfect, but which has virtues so real that it won me over all the same. It's an unlikely love story that takes place between the foreman of a painting crew and a young woman mountain climber from Australia. Not very likely, maybe, but it becomes convincing because of the performances of two recent Oscar nominees, Pete Postlethwaite and Rachel Griffiths. As the film opens, he's in charge of a ragtag gang of day laborers who are painting giant electrical pylons that march across the British landscape. And she is a backpacker who's looking for a job and isn't afraid of heights. So he gives her one.
Dig her out a pair of overalls. What, chest size, darling?
I just count your brown tails and double it. Should be about right.
And, of course, they fall in love. It's a romance that doesn't go over very well with his estranged wife, however, who it turns out he isn't quite divorced from.
Diamonds. Very nice. Meanwhile, I'm buying the kids clothes from the charity shop.
You're having a good time?
I hope you're very happy. I do. We'll sort out our divorce sometime, Ray.
Postlethwaite and Griffiths play very particular people, quirky and independent, stubborn and unpredictable, and their scenes together are so intriguing that I could sort of overlook some of the movie's contrivances, especially its fixation with setting as many scenes as possible on cliff tops and mountainsides and power pylons and even a water tower where he has a secret garden. The cinematographer must have been dangling from a helicopter for half of this movie. Those scenes look so good, I forgave them for being so unlikely, and the movie kind of got to me.
Well, you're more forgiving than I am, Roger. I couldn't forgive it. This film kind of got on my nerves. Partly, I'm just working class camaraderie out. I've had enough bonhomie between louts to last me a lifetime, you know? And I never bought the relationship. I kept saying, no, they wouldn't be doing this. No, they wouldn't be doing that. The whole thing irritated me.
Well, you know, they look like an unlikely couple because he's a good deal older than she is, and yet at the same time, they're both kind of completely alone, and they're rebels who, each in his own way, has kind of pulled aside from the rules of society, and they see that in each other. And so I believe that, and I also just love the two actors.
Oh, they're terrific actors.
I mean, they're just fun to watch and fun to listen to, and Rachel Griffiths, who was so good in Hillary and Jackie, is a rising star, and so, like I say, it's far from perfect, but enough for me.
No, it's not close enough for me because, I mean, it sounds good in the abstract. You're describing it. I say, that sounds like a good film. I didn't see that film. I think on paper that film works. On the screen, it does not work.
Okay, when we come back, Warren Beatty stars in my video pick of the week.
Week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
One thing you have to say for Warren Beatty, he makes his films by hand, crafting them lovingly out of original materials instead of just churning out assembly line formula films. And one of his most original films is my video pick of the week. It's Bulworth, the 1998 political drama about a U.S. senator who decides to put out a contract on his own life.
If I'm not dead by Monday morning, I'm going to stop payment on that check.
The conviction that he is about to die fills Bulworth with an enormous sense of freedom. He doesn't have to worry about opinion polls anymore or offending the voters. He can say anything he wants.
You say that the Democratic Party don't care about the African-American community?
Isn't that obvious? Hey, you got half of your kids out of work and the other half are in jail. Do you see any Democrat doing anything about it? So what are you going to do, vote Republican?
I mean, come on, you can have a billion-man march. If you don't put down that malt liquor and chicken wings and get behind somebody other than a running back who stabs his wife, you're never going to get rid of somebody like me.
Halle Berry is the young woman he picks up on his campaign travels around Los Angeles. They like each other, but is there a sinister buried agenda going on here?
This is Senator Jay Bulworth.
Hold on, Steve.
What does he have? Well, I'm Governor Tyrone Pinckney. And this year is Osgood, my Secretary of State, and my Attorney General, Denisha.
Hey, Mama Doll. We're feeding the senator.
Senator?
Warren Beatty shared an Oscar nomination for his screenplay, which celebrates the freedom of anarchy, as this U.S. senator says exactly what he thinks and becomes surprisingly popular and maybe even dangerous as a result. Bulworth is available on tape and DVD, and it's my video pick of the week. At the movies we reviewed this week, we both rejected The Mod Squad, a good-looking production with a Nancy Drew screenplay. We split on the animated film Doug's First Movie, which I felt didn't create compelling characters, but Ken liked the way it talks to kids without talking down to them. Neither of us really cared for A Walk on the Moon, a sexy pulp romance masquerading as a heartfelt family drama. But a split decision on EDtv with Matthew McConaughey. Ken thought it worked as a comedy. I thought it didn't do enough with the TV point of view. And finally, I enjoyed the quirky and lovable romance among giants, but Kim was not convinced by its characters. So Among Giants was the only one I liked on this show.
Yeah, for me, I felt about that the way I felt about everything. The actors were better than the material, and I just, it's so frustrating to see that.
Well, thanks a lot for being here. I'm going to see you next at the Cannes Film Festival.
I'll be there.
Okay, how about La Pizza, Wednesday night?
It's a deal.
Okay. Remember, you can hear our reviews on the web at siskel-ebert.com, part of Go Network. And next week, reviews of more new movies, including The Out-of-Towners with Goldie Hawn and Steve Martin having a midlife crisis in The Big Apple, and The Matrix, a science fiction thriller starring Keanu Reeves. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
History teaches us many lessons, one of which is few things last. Like a Moen faucet. Moen. Buy it for looks. Buy it for life.
1-800-CONTACTS. Exact same contact lenses delivered to your door for less than you're paying now. Call 1-800-CONTACTS. We deliver. You save.
Niagara Easy Iron Non-Start Spray helps you iron out tough wrinkles while keeping your casual clothes soft and natural. With Niagara, your clothes feel as good as they look.
Check out Meineke and get 50% off lifetime brake pads and shoes.
At Meineke, you won't pay a lot, but you'll get a lot.
I guarantee it.
Closed captioning for Siskel and Ebert is sponsored by...
Take a bite of Croissant Pockets Ham and Cheddar and discover smoked ham and real cheddar cheese in a crispy, flaky croissant crust.
What are you gonna pick?
Croissant Pockets.